Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath school lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular lesson is part of a series on rebellion and redemption, the story of the great controversy through Scripture. And now we've come to lesson 6 in that series for February 6 of 2016, entitled Victory in the Wilderness, and you might be able to guess what that's talking about. We're talking about the temptations of Jesus. And this will prove to be a very interesting lesson. But before we begin, we always like to ask the Holy Spirit to guide us as we pray. Our wonderful Father, once again, we recognize your presence and we thank you for being with us as we discuss your word and what it can mean to us and what it hopefully will mean to those who listen and watch. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. How many times can you think of in the Bible where we have record of Christ and Satan being in direct conflict?
Revelation, start with Revelation 12.
Revelation 12, the war in heaven, sure, okay.
If your eyes are open and a little intuitive, yeah, you can see it all the way, but okay, there are some places where it's
more obvious. Pick out some of the obvious ones.
Garden of Eden.
The Garden of Eden, of course, yes.
Temptation.
The temptations we're going to talk about now. What about Job? Job 1 and 2. Daniel 10 is very clear. What about on the cross?
How about Zechariah 3?
Zechariah 3, absolutely. We could think of quite a few places. So, the Garden of Gethsemane.
Calvary, mm-hmm, resurrection.
Would you say that there was a direct conflict between the devil and Jesus every time he cast out a demon from somebody?
Yeah.
What do you think was going on behind the scenes when he did that? I mean, I try to imagine these things in my mind. Jesus, what did Jesus say to his first group of disciples, Matthew 10, when he sent them out to travel around Galilee? And again to the people in Perea, in Luke 18, I believe it was.
He said something to them?
Yeah, what instructions did he give them?
Well, I think he felt that they'd been...
Heal the sick,
yeah,
cast out demons, raise the dead, preach the gospel.
I better get to work.
Yeah, exactly. And think about this. I mean, what do you think Satan thought as he's standing there watching, listening, and Jesus just sort of casually, and I'm sure it wasn't casually, he was very purposefully and carefully thought out and prayed about, and he sends 12 guys out to cast out demons.
And they come back with reports that that's what's happening.
Exactly. And later it's 72 guys he sends out. You go ahead and cast those demons out.
So would you say in these instances we have actually human beings,
yeah,
going head to head or
face
to face with the devil, although one needs to be careful about how that one interprets how much was actually the humans were, mm-hmm, maybe a little more abruptly
God
in the face, but nevertheless they weren't doing it on their own.
Mm-hmm. Well, going back to the Garden of Eden, because that's sort of where the whole problem started as far as we're concerned. What happened there? Would you say that in the battle between the tree of life and the tree of knowledge of good and evil, between God and the devil, who do you think won that battle?
What's your definition of one?
Well, that's why I asked you. I want you to tell me, based on your definition of winning.
Talking at the side, right there at the side of the tree, or are we talking in a cosmic sense?
Well, I'm talking about what resulted in their being thrown out of the garden. Include as much as you like in that. Would you call that a victory for Satan?
Well, if God had won, mm-hmm, fully there, we would still be in Eden.
Yeah.
Or better. Mm-hmm. We wouldn't be where we are right now.
Well, here's what Ellen White says about Satan's attitude about that situation. Remember the condemnation when God said to Adam and Eve, He curses the snake, and Satan realizes he's not talking just about snakes. He's talking about who?
Him.
Him. She says, yet as the plan of salvation was more fully unfolded, Satan rejoiced with his angels that, having caused man's fall, he could bring down the Son of God from his exalted position. And if you look through Ellen White, that is exactly what he wanted to do. He just wanted more than anything else to bring down Christ so he could be above him, right? He declared that his plan had thus far been successful upon the earth, and that when Christ should take upon himself human nature, he also might be overcome, and thus the redemption of the fallen race might be prevented. Now, we recoil at that, but that's Satan's goal. That's what he wants. Okay?
Well, maybe to try it out. Because no, that hadn't happened before, right?
What hadn't happened before?
What Satan's goal here.
Oh, yeah.
To pull him down.
He was going to try it, yeah.
But obviously it didn't work.
No.
Why couldn't it be argued that that objective was accomplished before he even came down here with humans? Wasn't that objective accomplished when a third of the angels followed him out of there?
Mm-hmm. But Satan is looking for a permanent habitation. And he would like this earth to be his permanent habitation. And what was God's response to that?
No, I'm going to make it my capital.
No way. I'm making this earth the place where I won the great controversy. I'm going to make this my future home. I'm sure that God did that very intentionally, or is going to do that very intentionally. Well, when Christ met Satan in the wilderness, it was not the first time they had been in conflict. We've made that pretty clear. Had Christ won all the previous battles? Come on, Gary, you're the one that was asking about...
Well, I'm still trying to figure out what one means. I mean...
Well, that's what I'm asking
you. Who would get the trophy? And what would the trophy be?
Well, here's what I can say. I can only quote Scripture.
Yeah, and how can God lose?
Yeah. What I quote from Scripture is, God himself refers to Satan as the prince of this earth. What does that tell you?
Prince of this earth. It actually says that?
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was the prince of death.
No. He calls him the prince of this earth.
Well, of course, there's death on this earth, so...
In Job, he's referred to the representative of earth.
Planet earth, yeah. So Christ is coming now to win back the one rebellious planet in the entire universe, right? So we need to keep in mind what he's actually coming to do.
To win back.
As our good friend Dennis said the last time he was here, and when God's purpose is to once again bring harmony mm-hmm. into the universe.
Yeah. Now let's think about this. Let's think through the issues here. If one has lost something in a war, how does she or he win it back? Now, you know, we can think about human wars. You have to go to battle with planes and tanks and all that kind of stuff. But what kind of weapons were used in the war between Christ and Satan?
Lies, deception,
words.
Threats, intimidation.
Words.
On the part of the adversary, and then truth on the part of God.
Yeah, okay. So now, if that's the kind of weapons that were used in that war, how is God, if lies are what brought us down, look at Eve. Now we're on the side of Satan. What's it going to take to win the war back?
Truth will set you free.
The truth will set you free. That's amazing.
So I'm still a little foggy on what you would see when you actually win. I mean, what is it that? Okay, if you lose, what do you see? And what if you win, what do you see? Mm-hmm. So what exactly
well,
is
clearly,
it?
Clearly, when God created this earth and made the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve were living in the garden, and Satan was confined to one tree, who was in charge?
God.
I mean, this was God's place. Satan was only a visitor. He had no domain. I mean, he's got one tree, okay?
He was, to use a current term, he was under license.
He was under license, that's right. Exactly. So now when Adam and Eve sin, and basically the entire human race, which is only two people at that point in time, the entire human race have joined Satan's side, he now claims victory. He says, the human race is on my side. I mean, come on now, you've got a little of imagination. You can think about how what
so
Satan would say.
Humans all on his side?
Well, that's what he would claim. They all sinned. They all ate the fruit.
I'm talking about victory here. I'm not talking about claims. I'm talking about what is the victory? What are you seeing here
if you had been standing there, in fact, the universe standing there and watching what was going on, I am sure they would have said, uh-oh, it looks like God just lost it.
You come down to the flood and what's left, you know, just before the flood. Yeah. There's Noah and maybe his family that are still communicating with God, no one else. That looks like losing, like God is losing.
So I don't see a victory there as long as there's a few people left.
Well,
do you?
The score is
99-0 and
time's almost expired.
And then you have to remember that there's going to be some people that'll lose their eternal life.
But you're thinking in long-term range. We're talking about short-term. I mean, it's easy for us now in the 21st century after Christ has been here on this earth. But if you had been right there, if you were watching, one of the angels watching as the world is being wiped out in a flood, you would say, boy, God, I'm sure glad you're being so successful, right? I don't think
so. Well, I'm seeing a battle there, but I'm not really seeing a victory yet.
Well, we can have victories and battles.
We're using these words victory that God has already won in all this.
Okay, but
I'm trying to see what it is.
We haven't got there yet.
Okay.
So, by the way, Christ winning it back. Could, you know, there's some views of salvation and so on that God won the victory by tricking Satan, deceiving Satan. That's
yeah, there's a common view back in the days shortly after after the early Christians, in the very early centuries, that basically taught that God, Satan claimed that the human race belonged to him. And God says, okay, I will agree to give you my son in exchange for the human race. And Satan says, hey, that's what I've always wanted. These guys, I don't want all these human beings. They're not going to do me any good. So he gives them to God in exchange for God's son. And then he discovers that he can't hold on to Jesus. And Jesus escapes. So God wins by tricking the devil. How does that sound?
Incorrect view.
An incorrect view?
Well, it's kind of hard to understand Satan's motives there.
Kind of hard to understand any of Satan's motives any place.
Well, I wonder if there is. We can understand them. We just don't know them yet.
Okay. So now we're talking about the temptation. So let's get into it. You know that they're presented in Matthew and Luke especially. Well, really only in Matthew and Luke. But if you read Matthew 1, 20 to 23, John 1, 1 to 3, Colossians 1, 15 to 20, and Hebrews 1, 1 to 13, what do you see?
The about temptations, you're talking about the time that Jesus went out into the desert for...
I'm trying to give us the background for that right now.
Yeah, okay. All right.
So these verses make it absolutely clear to anybody who reads the scriptures fairly that Jesus was not anything other than God himself, right? The one that's most famous probably is John 1, 1 to 3. Let me just read that. In the beginning, the Word already existed. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. Is there any question about that? From the very beginning, the Word was with God. Through him, God made all things. Not one thing in all creation was made without him. Okay? Does that sort of suggests that Jesus was...
Understanding that John is using the term word here as a What is the proper English term for that? It's not euphemism, but...
It's a title.
Yeah.
It's a title.
The word?
Yeah. Logos.
Logos.
Well, the word has meaning.
Yeah.
From which you get
in
logic.
These passages, the Bible writers made it very clear that it was God himself who came down to be Emmanuel, God with us. So now, can you spell out clearly several reasons why Jesus came to this earth?
Show what the Father was like. Show what God is like.
Well, our lesson mentions several of them, and let's see what we can learn from these. He came to restore what Adam had lost, and that's basically Romans 5. On several occasions while he was on this earth, the crowds wanted to make him king. So what did the Jewish people think the Messiah was going to do for them? They wanted a Messiah who would help them kill the Romans, not a Messiah who would be killed by the Romans. That was all backwards, right?
We're looking for another Saul, only a better one.
A better Saul. Okay. And two, Jesus came, lived, and died to give us a clear choice. Each of us must decide if we want to live a life like his or if we want to die as he died. And there's a couple of passages, John 9 and 1 John 3. Thus he brought judgment to human beings. In what way did Jesus destroy the works of the devil? That's God's words, not mine. Destroyed the works of the devil. In what way did he bring judgment? Did dying on the cross destroy the works of the devil?
I'm more impressed with the life that Jesus lived than his death.
Does his life bring judgment to anybody?
It brings separation. It makes people make a decision.
Yeah.
For or against, which is a judgment call on part of some.
A righteous life can certainly bring condemnation to an under-righteous life.
Okay. Well, number three, Luke 19:10 tells us clearly that Jesus came to seek and save the lost. Who are the lost ones? That would be us, right?
Yeah.
His plan was to take away our sins, John 1:29. What did Jesus need to do to seek and save the lost?
Get their bearings.
Have to change.
I mean, when you're lost, you need to be
found.
You need to be found. Well, not only that, but you have to get yourself coordinated back
to where you were supposed to be. Huh?
Well, knowing where you're at somehow.
You have to change the heart of the lost in this case.
Well, there's a challenge here. Here's a question that was raised by Abelard in the 11th or 12th century A.D. And it is not fully answered by Christians, virtually any Christians today. Let me see if I can put it to you, okay? Don't we believe God is all-powerful, omnipotent?
Mm-hmm.
You believe that?
Yeah.
Make sure. Do we all agree about that? Okay? If he's all-powerful, omnipotent, why couldn't he save us without someone having to die?
He could save us. It's just that we wouldn't understand why we would be saved.
Well, on the other hand, if God is not willing to save us without someone dying, how can we believe that he's loving, kind, and trustworthy? Because I'm not going to save you until I get my pound of flesh, right? Is that what God says?
It depends on what Abelard thought was.
He just posed some obvious questions.
Well, that's what he thought was the consequence of Jesus dying.
Yeah. What do you think is the consequence of Jesus dying?
Well, I think the consequence is a demonstration of what evil will do to its own God.
Okay.
Romans 5:10.
Yeah. Surely at any time God could have destroyed the devil, right?
Yes.
Don't we believe he's powerful? He could just unplug the devil any time, just pull out his electricity or whatever, you know? Why didn't he? Wouldn't that have been the best solution? I mean, that's what a military guy would do today if he had that option. I mean, Think of what's going on in Syria now. Wouldn't we just love to unplug the ISIS?
But you wouldn't change the thinking on the part of the intelligent creatures by just doing something like that.
Change the thinking. Now, there's an interesting
idea.
Well,
what if Satan wanted to be unplugged? If he was unplugged and he disappeared, that would prove that God's way. You have to go his way or you
die.
You are unplugged. You're going to get unplugged.
So who's keeping sin going?
Well, that's the question. Why is the devil alive and well on planet Earth?
God's
in
keeping
him
alive.
In 2015, 2016.
Well, that's kind of my point.
When you pose that question, you're assuming that the devil is what's keeping sin going. And if something...
God is.
God is.
If sin is separation from God, and nothing can live separated from God, all God has to do is let it go. God is keeping everybody connected.
If something were to happen to the devil, if he were to die right now, sin would continue because the fact that I am sinning is that's my doing. That's not the devil's.
James 1.
Right.
Yeah, but it would probably diminish at least somewhat. Satan was gone.
Taper off.
Oh, there'd be somebody that would step up and take his place.
It wouldn't. Yeah,
it
wouldn't.
It is.
Yeah, no. I agree with that. But now, I'm going to suggest that Jesus came, number four, primarily to show us what God is like.
Exactly.
He came to correctly represent the Father so that we could have good evidence for knowing who can be trusted and who is telling us the truth.
Why was that necessary?
Well,
I mean, I can understand how he would come and show me, but I mean, this is all part of a series of lessons on the great controversy where the universe is. Why is it the universe needs to know this? Didn't they know this to begin with?
Why was devil successful in winning a third of the angels?
Deception.
Well, that doesn't sound very good when you're saying that God created a perfect universe, except all of a sudden now we're discovering that a lot of people are a lot of beings and so forth are
don't really seem to understand everything.
That's the problem of freedom and love.
What did the devil say in the Garden of Eden to Eve? He said, God's a liar. He can't be trusted.
Well,
has he really told you that you'll die?
God
no,
has said that
you're not going
to
die.
Sin leads to death, and Satan said it will not lead to death.
Well, I can understand that with Eve and her problem, but it is a real big question with this. Our concept of the great controversy is how the rest of the universe could have these lingering doubts.
They needed this Earth's experience in order to answer the questions that they had.
Exactly. We are the theater of the universe.
Well, I hear that, but it's hard for me to understand why that is.
What happens if Jesus came and showed us God and we didn't like it?
A lot of us don't. A lot of
that's people
John
don't.
17,
you can reject it.
Then what happens? Then what happens?
They die.
John
said,
they
reject
die?
Him. The people who reject them ultimately.
So you better like God or you'll die.
Well,
But it's not because.
Yeah, but I don't like God,
It's not because you're zapped, it's because you were separating yourself from the life source.
Do we need to read the verse from Isaiah 59, verse 2? I'll read it for you. It is because of your sins that he doesn't hear you. It is your sins that separate you from God when you try to worship him. And if you're separated from God, we could read another verse. If you're separated from God, who's the source of life, guess what happens? Do we believe that or don't we believe it? That's the question. Do we believe? Every day as we carry on our sinful lives, do we actually believe every time we're committing sin that we are separating ourselves from God and we're choosing death instead of life? Well, do we believe that?
I usually come to that conclusion after I've suffered the consequences.
I see. Well, let's read through
the rest. When I'm actually doing the deed, I'm distracted.
Yeah. If Satan conquered our original parents by persuading them to believe a lie, what does Jesus need to do to win us back? Doesn't he need to tell the truth? What does it actually mean to trust someone or to have faith in someone? Did Jesus manage to show us the truth about God? And here's an incredible statement that has basically not been copied anywhere, except Ellen White wrote it one time, 1890, January 20, 1890, Signs of the Times. Christ exalted the character of God, attributing to him the praise and giving to him the credit of the whole purpose of his mission on earth. Okay, what's the whole purpose of his mission on earth?
Reveal the Father to the...
To set man right through the revelation of God. And Christ was arrayed before men, the paternal grace and the matchless perfections of the Father. In his prayer, just before his crucifixion, he declared, I have manifested thy name, I have glorified thee on the earth, I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. Okay? Finish the work. You're talking about the life. When the object of his mission was attained, and now it's the third time he's going to talk about it, the revelation of God to the world, what was his mission? The revelation of God to the world, the Son of God announced that his work was accomplished and that the character of the Father was made manifest to men. Four times in one paragraph, he says the whole purpose, the purpose is to make manifest the revelation of God. That was his, I mean, she says that's his whole story.
But even with that whole statement there, it doesn't guarantee that you're going to like what you see.
If God could guarantee anything, he would have done it right in heaven, but when the great controversy started, he can't. Not and allow us freedom. If he's going to allow us freedom, if he wants to have love, he has to allow freedom. And allowing freedom, he cannot force us to choose for his side.
Okay,
give us a description of not liking what you're seeing here.
Well, it's simple. You roll out a car, you either like it or you don't. You roll out God, you either like it or you don't. If you don't like it, what happens?
Well, it's my understanding that you eventually do like what you see.
You will, no matter what. I mean,
but
God is so good that you will like it, I guess.
Well, what he said is, what the Bible says is to know God is to love him.
To know God is to love him. What if you know him and you don't love him? Well, you think that's possible?
That means you've chosen Satan's side.
You've made a judgment call for yourself.
Satan did know God.
But doesn't Satan know God?
Satan does know God because he was the closest one to him.
He knew God, but he didn't appreciate God. If you made that kind of a decision, you'd be doing the same thing. You're basically saying one of two things. Either I think I know better than God does, I'm going to do it my way, or you're so jealous and so envious, you say, I'm going to do this as spite against God.
Terminal self-centeredness.
Yeah. Well, the children of Israel saw this John the Baptist coming down and preaching and baptizing on the other side of the Jordan. It had been 400 years, more than 400 years, since there had been a prophet in Israel.
Now, is this a legitimate prophet, or been 400 years since they'd had a legitimate prophet? Yeah. It's my understanding there were other people around.
Yeah, a legitimate prophet, yeah, one they would recognize. Why did John the Baptist use language suggesting the final judgment when he was giving his introduction to the Messiah? Did the coming of Jesus bring a kind of final judgment to the Jewish people? Or did the Jewish leaders bring judgment on Jesus?
Is John the Baptist preaching to the Jews or to the world?
Or both. People gathered from all kinds of places to hear him preach. Well, while you're thinking about that, there are interesting parallels between the story of the children of Israel leaving Egypt and traveling to the Promised Land and the story of Jesus himself. Neither John nor Jesus attempted to lead any kind of political movement either among the Jews or against the Romans. What did they preach? They quoted Isaiah and Jeremiah suggesting that God would prepare a world or a way in the world for society's most vulnerable. God is coming down to reach out to the blind, the lame, the pregnant, mothers with toddlers, and for all who seek salvation from their sins. That's very interesting. Look at Luke 24, 25 to 27. And Jesus said to them, now here is, this is Resurrection Sunday, okay? It's late in the afternoon. Some of the lesser known disciples of Jesus are traveling about 7 miles back from Jerusalem to Emmaus. And Jesus walks with them. You remember the story, hopefully. Then Jesus said to them, and they, you know, they said, are you the, they said to Jesus, I always have to, I just love this story. They said, are you the only one in Jerusalem who doesn't know what's been happening here this weekend? And Jesus, he must have had a hard time keeping a straight face when they said that. Then Jesus said to them, how foolish you are, how slow you are to believe everything the prophet said. Was it not necessary for the Messiah to suffer these things and then to enter his glory? And Jesus explained to them what was said about himself in all the scriptures, beginning with the books of Moses and the writings of all the prophets. Okay?
Where's that description?
That's what I want to know.
Where's all the things that Jesus said about himself so yeah. we can...
What do you think, what passages from the Old Testament do you think he quoted from? Did he have access maybe to some inspired writings that we don't have anymore?
Isaiah 9.
Well, Isaiah 9, Isaiah 53.
No, he probably talked all about Job and all about Abraham and all about Moses and Jacob and the whole thing.
Okay, now, so if that's the case,
then just...
God's so-called faithful people in Jesus' day so thoroughly misunderstood his first coming, is there a possibility that we might misunderstand his second coming? Yeah. No, we couldn't be wrong, right?
Yeah. People are just as lazy today as they were back then.
The Jews wanted a Messiah who would come and help them conquer their enemies or at least get rid of their enemies.
Whoa, now wait just a root and toot minute here. Mm-hmm. They believed in a literal king that was coming.
Yeah.
They read those descriptions in the Old Testament, and so they thought this king was going to come. So they had a very literal interpretation of what was going to happen. Now we have the New Testament, and we read very literally that Jesus is going to come in the clouds of heaven, and that every eye shall see him, and all of this stuff. What makes you think us? We're not reading all of that and interpreting, making the same mistake, reading it understanding it literally when really it isn't literally. He's not going to come where every eye can see him, literally in the clouds of heaven. How do we know we're not making?
We need at least to ask that question. Whether it's a serious question or not, at least we need to ask ourselves that question.
I did. What's the answer? I just ask it. Gordon looked like he has an answer over there.
Well, the Jews, there's a first coming of Jesus, second coming of Jesus, and third coming of Jesus, at least those. We know about those from the New Testament. The disciples and all the Jews thought all of those events were conglomerated into one event. That's what they were waiting for.
They were reading the stories of the prophecies. There are a few prophecies in the Old Testament about things that we now know are going to happen at the second coming, and even a few things that are going to happen at the third coming. And they were looking for those things at the first coming.
Yeah. Well, but my question was elaborating basically on what your question was how do we know that we're not making a mistake in some things? And I just picked some things that are kind of dear to us.
Yeah, and the answer is we need to keep reading and keep reading and make sure we don't make any mistakes. But anyway, our time here is to talk about the temptations. Let's go to some of that. it's a good question. I wish we had a lot of time to talk about it. Matthew 4, 1 to 3. Then the Spirit led Jesus into the desert to be tempted by the devil.
Compare that with Luke.
We've got a good cooperation here between God and the devil here. Is that what's happening? Well, Gordon says we should compare Luke.
Same part of Luke.
Look at Luke 4, 1. Jesus returned from the Jordan full of the Holy Spirit and was led by the Spirit into the desert where he was tempted by the devil for 40 days. That's a little different, isn't it? Why did Jesus actually go out there into the desert? He wouldn't just intentionally put himself in the way of temptation, would he?
Well, sometimes when you need to focus and concentrate, you need to get away and and have an undisturbed and uncluttered mind, and so you just get away and think a while.
Okay. I'm going to take a couple of quotations here from Ellen White. It is impossible for man to fully comprehend the strength of Satan's temptations to our Savior. Every enticement to evil, which men find so difficult to resist, was brought to bear upon the Son of God in as much greater degree as his character was superior to that of fallen man. Boy, would that give you a shake in the boots.
So that means I don't have to experience such temptations.
Do you think you could survive it? Shall I answer that question?
Don't ask a question and respond. As an answer.
So what would be the purpose of even doing that if the temptations were so hard, so powerful that we couldn't hold them up?
That's what we're going to try to answer, okay?
Okay.
Well, it was probably a temptation to see if God could live up to his own laws.
No, it wasn't. But that's what a lot of people would say. I'm reading on. This is Spirit Prophecy, Volume 2. If some of you will remember the four-volume series that preceded the five-volume Conflict of the Ages series written in the 1870s, Christ, in behalf of the race, was to conquer appetite. Now, none of us have a problem with appetite, I know, but by enduring the most powerful test on that point, he was to tread the path of temptation alone with none to help or comfort him. Alone, he was to wrestle with the powers of darkness and exercise a self-control stronger than hunger or death. The length of this fast is the strongest evidence of the great sinfulness of debased appetite and its power over the human family. Should that warn us of a thing or two?
It does. What does she mean in behalf of the human race? I mean, the way that's phrased, he's going to do something.
Yes.
For us, okay. So that we don't have to do it. I mean, that would be kind of a...
Let's answer that. Satan had claimed that it would be impossible for any human being, to live a perfect, sinless life here on this earth. Who has done it?
Jesus.
Only Jesus.
Yeah, but the purpose of it could be two things. One is to say it could be done. The other one might be to prove that he was God. Because the law is the character of God. So if he could stand all those terrible, terrible temptations, he would have the character of God.
Okay, well, listen, let's work our way through this. Jesus was not led into the wilderness for the purpose of being tempted by the devil. The devil approached Jesus when he thought he had an edge because of the fasting that Jesus had done. And I read from Ellen White again, Desire of Ages, page 114. When Jesus was led into the wilderness to be tempted, he was led by the Spirit of God. He did not invite temptation. He went to the wilderness, to be alone, to contemplate his mission and work. By fasting and prayer, he was to brace himself for the blood-stained path he must travel. But Satan knew that the Savior had gone into the wilderness, and he thought that this was the best time to approach him. Now, this is the way I picture this.
So by fasting and praying, there is some strength that can be derived from that.
Yeah. This is the way I picture that, and you don't have to agree with this, but this is my way of understanding that. I think that every day in his life, Jesus began with a period of prayer and communion with his Father. And sometimes we're told, Luke 6, for example, he prayed all night because what he was doing, I am sure, is planning with the Father what he was going to do the next day. Now, here we have a period of 40 days, and he's laying out his entire future life. They're saying, okay, blow by blow, this is how we're going to defeat the devil.
How would you be able to do that unless you could look in through time and
think of all the things
that are going to... Well, then Jesus would know what's going to happen all the way through. Is that good enough for you?
If you know that God's going to win in the great controversy, is that enough for you?
Well, I'm talking about knowing all the ins and outs, who's going to do what, and what he's going to respond to and everything. And if he could do that, that doesn't happen with me.
Okay,
but I mean, I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow.
I'm
not sure that if Ken is right here, that there was a moment-by-moment agenda what was going to happen.
Yeah.
There were goals and how you could accomplish those goals and probably what maybe the objections you were going to encounter, either human or... And that was the idea was how to prepare for those. I mean, that.
I think it was Jesus was living as a human being. We're going to read some quotations about that in a little bit. When he's actually on the cross, when he felt he needed God's presence the most of all, Ellen White says specifically he could not see through the portals of the tomb. So, whatever God said to him. I'm sure God assured him of his presence and all that kind of stuff, probably many times, but he was still functioning as a human being. He could not see. He felt like the devil tried to convince him on the cross that if he died, he would be forever separated from his Father. As a human being, that's what he thought was going to happen. So, let's move on. Do we know of anybody else who found Jesus in the wilderness during those temptations?
Well, there was some.
Cousin John.
Yeah.
This is a very interesting passage. And see if I can get my little machine to work here. This is talking about Jesus now. He's been away from his mother, separated from his mother for quite a length of time. During this period, he'd been baptized by John and had endured the temptation of the wilderness. Rumors had reached Mary concerning his son and his sufferings. John, one of the new disciples, had searched for Christ and had found him in his humiliation, emaciated and bearing the marks of great physical and mental distress. Jesus, unwilling that John should witness his humiliation, had gently yet firmly dismissed him from his presence. He wished to be alone. No human eye must behold his agony. No human heart be called out in sympathy with his distress.
No.
Volume 2 of the Spirit of Prophecy, page 99, paragraph 2.
There's no scriptural passage to go with that?
No, there isn't.
That's
Ellen White. So.
I'm just wondering what the purpose of that whole thing is. He just didn't want him to see. Was it embarrassing for him that...
I don't think embarrassing. I think Jesus realized that John wouldn't have understood what was really going on.
Would have impaired his ability to focus on what he needed to
probably,
focus on.
Probably, yeah.
And Jesus may have felt like if John was disconcerted in any way, then Jesus would need to focus on helping John and therefore be distracted from...
And I wonder what John actually did say when he went back. Did he say, Jesus is out there and he's dying, you know? Well, when Satan appeared to Jesus in the wilderness, what was his demeanor? Did he appear with horns and a forked tail?
No.
Or did he appear as a bright, shining angel? And what did he say to Jesus? Now, I put a whole lot of references up here I didn't have time to mention, but on our website, if you go and look for our website and you look for this handout, there's a whole, Ellen White wrote pages and pages about these temptations. It's under number 11 in our handout. All kinds of material on what all was going on here.
What's the name of our website?
Theox, theox.org. Thank you.
It's actually item number 10.
It's actually item number 10, correction. So what does Satan appear? He appears like a bright, shining angel. He says, you know what? I've heard a rumor that there was some despicable character that fell from heaven. Maybe you're that guy. However, Satan could not conceal his identity, because very quickly, what did he do? He said, if you are the Son of God, and immediately Jesus knew what? Who he was dealing with.
Any good angel would know that this was the Son of God. There needed to be if.
Many writers, including Bible writers, have compared and contrasted the fall of Adam and Eve with the victory of Jesus in the wilderness. And an obvious example is Romans 5. How would you compare the temptation that even then Adam faced with the temptations that Christ faced? I mean, were Adam and Eve suffering at all for lacking fruit? They did not suffer one tiny little bit. And Jesus literally was on the verge of death to try to prove that humans, as a human, you could survive. Well, if Jesus had turned a stone into bread, would it have proved anything? Satan would have come back with another argument. It would not have proved anything. But Jesus...
There are a lot better proofs.
Yeah. Jesus proved his divinity by coming to this earth, living as a human being, and descending to the point of death on the cross. Philippians 2, 5 to 8.
The fact that Jesus was actually in the wilderness experiencing these things was proof enough.
Yep. Satan sought to trick Jesus by quoting from Scripture in his second temptation. Remember what it says in Psalm 91, verses 11 and 12? God will put his angels in charge of you to protect you in all your ways, or to protect you wherever you go. They will hold you up with their hands to keep you from hurting your feet on the stones. You will trample down lions and snakes and so forth.
Yeah, we read about these three temptations, and they don't seem to be like such a significant thing.
Have you ever been tempted to turn a stone into bread?
Well, I think the reason that doesn't seem like such a significant thing to me is I've never been that hungry.
Well, that might be part of it.
You know, Jesus' circumstance here, all of these things may have been a real tempting thing.
To Jesus, they were a terrible temptation because he could turn stones into bread if he wanted to use his divine power for his own benefit.
And he was hungry enough to...
He was hungry enough to eat stones.
But he decided not to do it because of why?
Well, what would it prove? He would have accomplished absolutely nothing. You think he would have convinced the devil by turning a stone into bread? No way.
He didn't need to prove anything to anybody.
No.
So the temptation was just to feed his stomach. That's the only thing?
Well, if you're about to die from starvation, that's a pretty important thing.
I don't know. I heard that when you're about ready to die from starvation, you're not hungry anymore.
Well,
I haven't been there, so I don't know.
Yeah, I've heard well, that from people.
You know, not only hunger, but, you know, we talk about this distance on the cross. Is it possible he may have felt a similar distance here in some way? And so that's why it would have been tempting to want to prove you were connected with God in this very intimate way.
What would he have accomplished by jumping off the top of the temple? Anything? No.
It would have showed that the angels do bear you up.
So what?
Well, I kind of think that these were the beginnings of a sequence of temptations that we don't know the next one after this one, you know, that lead him to whatever, and he just didn't even start. So
we also have to remember here something that you've pointed out is that you know, we think of this and we think of Jesus as God. Well, you know, he's really a human. This is a really human experience here, and the doubts and the temptations that are available to a human, he's God, and in a sense, a bit of his integrity as God is challenged here, and therefore the temptation to
Jesus.
Let me
try to add to what you've just said. Jesus, there were temptations that could be forced upon Jesus. There would never be a temptation to me. He He had a lot of temptations I don't even have, because he could have turned the stone into bread. If Satan said to me, go ahead and turn this stone into bread, I would just laugh, because I can't. But Jesus could. There's lots of things that Jesus was tempted on that wouldn't be a temptation to me at all. I mean, if I'm up there on top of the temple, I'm hanging on for dear life. But Jesus knew that he could jump off and the angels would catch him if he chose to do, if he felt that God wanted him to do that, he would have done it.
And therefore, it was important that he did not use his divine power to solve these problems. And if so,
for his own personal benefit.
Why was that? Why was it?
Because Jesus chose, he came here with the purpose of living and dying exactly as a human being, not doing anything that we couldn't do.
As a true teacher, all he could use was words to convey the message. The only place where the ultimate demonstration was at the cross, and he suffered the abuse at the hands of his creatures. But all the rest of the time, his teaching was with words.
Well, we need to get through some more points here before we run out of time. The third temptation. Finally, Satan just gives up his mask and he realizes Jesus knows perfectly well who he is. So he says, okay, I can give you a shortcut to the end of this. You don't have to go through all this stuff. You don't have to do all this starvation stuff. You can just go straight to victory. All you have to do is kneel down to me.
Does the devil show up to me that way? Does he show up with temptations?
He tempts you to be proud.
With the idea that it's not really the devil?
Mm-hmm. After this third temptation, Jesus summarily dismissed the devil. This is a really important point. There is no way Satan could resist his command. Thus, Christ did actually prove his divinity. And I quote now from Ellen White, still this volume 2 of Spirit of Prophecy, page 96, paragraph 2. Satan had asked Christ to give him evidence that he was the Son of God, and he had. In this instance, the proof he asked, he had no power to withstand his peremptory dismissal and was compelled to obey the divine command. Writhing with baffled hate and rage, the rebel chief retired from the presence of the world's Redeemer. The contest was ended. Christ's victory was as complete as had been the failure of Adam. So, in each of his defenses, Jesus had quoted Scripture. What does that tell us about how we should meet temptation? As Seventh-day Adventists, we have been presented the correct picture of the great controversy between God and Satan. No one else has come even close. Atheists and poets such as T.S. Eliot and Friedrich Nietzsche, which are quoted in our lesson, have talked about the conflict between good and evil. We're not talking about a conflict between good and evil. We're talking about a conflict between, or not just, we're talking about a conflict between God and Satan about who's telling us the truth. No one has spelled it out as Ellen White has, as she reads and understands Scripture. Would you have been tempted by any of the temptations that Jesus was tempted by? What are the main classes of temptations? Would the Ten Commandments be some kind of a clue? We need to ask ourselves repeatedly, why did Jesus come to this world? Was it just to die to pay the price of sin? That's what a lot of our Christian friends would say. Why did he have to die? Can we explain what was the purpose of his life and his death? Well, we have Ellen White's comment we read earlier in number 6, paragraph part 4, I think it was. Jesus came to this earth to answer the questions that have been raised right in the Garden of Eden. Has God told us the truth that sin leads directly to death? Or was Satan correct when he claimed God was lying? By his life and his death, Jesus demonstrated beyond the possibility of doubt for those who are willing to take an unbiased look who it was who won in the great controversy, and who can be trusted, and who is even now telling us the truth. Whether we recognize it or not, the great controversy is being played out in each of our lives. Our minds are the battlefields of the great controversy. Some have suggested that we have to, quote, rely on Christ's strength in order to overcome and withstand temptation. How do you do that? Oh, temptations come at us frequently and from every direction. What is the secret to overcoming temptation as Jesus did? Well, there's at least two things we can say for sure. One, to conquer sin, we must try to stop it as soon as we recognize it as a temptation. It is deadly to play with temptation. Two, we must learn to crowd sin out of our lives by filling our lives with God's ideas and God's thoughts so the devil's ideas and thoughts have no room. Those things I know for sure. There might be other things, but those I know. Do we really believe that everything that God has told us is for our best good? Each time we sin, if we are aware of what we are doing, we are saying that we are choosing to do our will instead of God's will. While we cannot do anything to change our hearts or to bring ourselves into harmony with God, while we must not trust at all to ourselves or our good works, our lives will reveal whether the grace of God is dwelling within us. A change will be seen in the character, the habits, and the pursuits. The contrast will be clear and decided between what they have been and what they are. The character is revealed not by occasional good deeds and occasional misdeeds. You know about people like David who made one terrible mistake and followed up with several other terrible mistakes. But that's not the end of the story. It's not an occasional good deed or bad deed that makes our life up, but by the tendency of the habitual words and acts. Steps to Christ, page 57, paragraph 2. The good news is not primarily that God can save you and me. That is a selfish attitude. The real good news is that God can be trusted. Would you even want to be saved if God were the kind of person that Satan has made him out to be? Arbitrary, vengeful, exacting, tyrannical, unforgiving, and severe? It would never be safe even to be in his presence. I'm going to drop down here. Christ was not to exercise divine power for his own benefit. He had come to bear trials as we must do, leaving us an example of faith and submission. Neither here, talking about the wilderness, nor at any subsequent time in his earthly life did he work a miracle in his own behalf. His wonderful works were all for the good of others. Desire of Ages 119, paragraph 3. Our loving Father, what an incredible demonstration that was, and what it teaches us. Jesus, going to the point of death, he fell almost dying there in the wilderness, just as he fell almost dying in Gethsemane several years later. Angels had to come and revive him, we read in the writings of Ellen White. But Lord, forgive us for making it necessary for you to go through all of that. But at the same time, strengthen us to learn what you want us to learn from that experience is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.